It's usually good to talk about microbes after people eat, but mostly I won't be talking about gross microbes until maybe right at the end. All right, thanks for inviting me here, and always good to get out of my little cluster in Davis and get into the neighborhood. What I want to do today is talk about this quest I have, or many people have maybe now, but I've had this quest for a while, to generate a field guide to the microbes. And really, you probably could say that this is an obsession of mine. I have a lot of obsessions. So the first part of my talk, I'm going to tell you about some of my obsessions quickly, hopefully. So you've already heard about one of them. I am a passionate, kind of insanely passionate advocate for open access to scientific and medical literature for scientists and others, if they're funded in particular by government money, to publish their papers in ways that are freely and openly and unrestricted available to the community. But I'm not going to talk about that, although I'd love to convince you of the righteousness of my way there. I'm also a bit obsessed with social media and science, and I've been tweeting in the back of the room and probably blogging as soon as I get done with this, posting my slides. And I really think that social media and science go together very well, and it's a very useful way to learn about what other people are doing and to share information about science. But not going to talk about that either. I have a shrine to the Red Sox in my office. I was born in Boston, but I'm not going to talk about that. This is what I'm going to talk about, and sadly and scarily, I don't remember this, but my mom, who was cleaning out her house one day, you know, as moms do, and said, "Here's yet another box of your stuff." And inside that box, I found this paper. In ninth grade, in English class, we could write our own essay question and then answer it. And I am such a dork that my essay question, and look at that cue. I mean, my essay question was, describe one step in the evolution of a bacterium. I don't remember having any interest in bacteria. When I first went to college, I was an East Asian studies major until I switched to biology. But apparently this has been an obsession for a while. So I will talk about this a little bit. But actually, I'm going to start with yet another obsession, which is birds. I got into science and biology as a kid. I was definitely interested, and I got into it because I was a birder as a kid. I carried binoculars everywhere. We went on family hiking and backpacking and camping trips, and I was the family birder. And I have bird books, and I collect field guides, and I'm a serious amateur birder. I now go to Yolo Basin almost every morning, and I schedule conference calls, so I have my conference calls while hiking around Yolo Basin and putting my phone on mute and taking pictures. I now actually like conference calls and schedule them in particular in the morning. So I'm going to tell you a story about this one bird as an introduction here. This bird was seen at this place or somewhere like this place, and you saw it on the sort of corner there, and there was this bird singing in this lovely location. And what bird is this? Yeah, so it's an American robin. If you didn't know that, you could figure it out. You could get out your trusty bird guide and go to the page where thrushes are and figure out, you know, you should know what a robin is. But anyway, you can look it up. You can learn information about its geographical distribution, its ecology, its evolution, its feeding, etc. from looking in the field guide if you're, you know, oh, I put my phone away. But if you're, you know, a total bird geek, you have iPhone apps or other apps that have the field guide on there, and I post observations to eBird and share information about the birds I see, and there's the American robin, and you can find the map on the iPhone app, and that's, you know, really lovely. So when this American robin was seen at this site, if you zoom out, there's one issue with this, which is, this was not in America. This was in the United Kingdom, and this was maybe 5 or 6 years ago that an American robin was spotted there. And birders, like me, are obsessive folks. This was before Twitter, but the Twitchers in England, the obsessed birders, shared you know, one person saw it and then they sent some email message to someone else, and then there's some discussion group that people posted that the American Robin is out there, and this was exciting because, of course, it doesn't belong there, and if they had their English version of the iPhone app or an English field guide, they would say, oh my God, this does not belong here. And so all these people showed up, they were very excited, you know, here's this American, I mean, you know, in the US, it's just a damn robin. But they got very, very excited about this, and people were, you know, all out there with their fancy camera equipment, and then it was eaten by a hawk. It just happens. But that's not the point of this story here, poor robin, I know. The point of the story is that because there are field guides, like the field guide to the birds, people know where birds are supposed to be. They know what they look like. They know if they see a new bird, how to identify it. They know things about its niche and its ecology and its behavior, distribution patterns over space and time. And what I want is the equivalent for microbes. I want to have a catalog of the organisms and the functional diversity and the biogeography and so on. And that's what I want. I want a field guide to the microbes. Now, it's ridiculous. I mean, it's completely absurd. Birds, there are something like, I think, 8,000 species of birds on the planet. There are probably hundreds of millions of species of microbes. And, you know, they're small. There's going to be a very complicated field guide here, right? And I've been talking about this to people since college. And it was completely... I shouldn't have even put question marks here. It was completely ludicrous 20 years ago to even think of having a real field guide to all the microbes. I don't mean just one group of microbes. People actually have made field guides to various individual groups of microbes, but I mean all microbes. And so that's what I want to talk to you about today, is how we can get there. So first, a little bit of introduction, and if anybody's still eating, there's nothing really bad here. Microbes, they're a challenge for a lot of reasons for studying, and in particular for doing things like biogeography and ecology and field guides, because they're small, they're incredibly numerous in terms of total numbers and the kinds that are out there. And in particular, the biggest problem that we have is that their appearance, physical appearance, if you look at them in a microscope or with other means, is not a good indicator of what kind of microbe they are or what their potential is. Unlike the robin, you know, if you see a particular type of new thrush, even if you'd never seen a thrush, you know, that particular one before, you might be able to guess it's a bird, and you might be able to guess things about its biology from its appearance, and we just can't do that very well with most microbes. There's an incredible diversity of form, but the form is not very informative as to what kind that you're looking at. There's also an incredible diversity of functions, so we think they're interesting and important, and it's well documented that microbes do all sorts of interesting things. There are the bad ones that kill us, there are the good ones that help other organisms, such as the nitrogen-fixing symbionts of legumes. There are the weird ones, those are the ones I tend to study, that live in extreme environments. They're the ones that people like to eat and drink, or get them to make food and beverages. There's now a growing rise in interest in using microbes for all sorts of other purposes, like biofuel generation. And of course, they kind of run the planet, or at least global biogeochemical cycles. So there's lots of interest in microbes. But again, there's this challenge where there are a lot of them, and their physical appearance is not that useful. And so, where do we go then? How do we get to this point where there's a field guide to the microbes? And I think we can actually start to get there. You can go out and do field work, right? I mean, it's not that you can't do field work on microbes. So for plant and animal studies, people have been doing field studies for thousands of years, in essence, and, you know, even publishing papers for hundreds of years on this, and writing tomes and books, and you can go out and collect butterflies and do transects, and you can do global biogeography now with satellite imagery, and you can do all sorts of studies. I like this picture because there's the bird on his head. You can use, you know, field assisting devices to see them, but you don't even need that for many macro organisms. And you can do the same type of thing for microbes. So you can go out and collect field samples. People do this all sorts of places studying microbial diversity. You can do global biogeographical patterns. You can use satellite imagery. You can do small scale ecology. You can look at them with a microscope. You can use, you know, assisting devices to go to the bottom of the ocean. There's lots of really interesting field work on microbes. And I don't mean to say that that doesn't help us, but again, because of the scale of the problem, the hundreds of millions of kinds and the just complexity of mapping from physical appearance in a microscope or physiological observations to understanding the diversity, this just has not worked out that well. So what most people do if they really want to learn what's going on in a microbe is they go to an environmental sample, and instead of, you know, well, in addition to studying something in the field, you bring back a sample to the lab and you grow the microbe in the lab, hopefully in isolation, called culturing. So you grow it separately from everything else. Clonal organisms, this works pretty well with, like many bacterial species, and you just basically make a replicate of what you saw in the environment. And then you can take those cultures and study the evolution, the biochemistry, the genomics, the physiology, everything about that microbe in the laboratory. And this has, you know, of course, you know, I assume almost everybody here has done this with many microbes. But there's a problem with that too, and talking to, you know, teachers, I always talk about the GPA, and they get confused as to what I mean by that. So what I'm talking about is something called the Great Plate Count Anomaly. It's known as the GPA in the microbial world. And what it is if you go to an environment, really any environment, but here is a Yellowstone hot spring, which has microbes that you can see in the microscope all throughout, you know, different parts of the hot spring, but you could do the same thing with soil and with gut samples. And you take the sample and you split it in two. And you look in half the sample, you look in the microscope, and you count how many cells you see. You could count the living cells if you had a way of staining the living ones, but you could just count total cells that you see in the microscope. And you take the other half of the sample and you try and grow in the laboratory, in culture, the microbes that are present in that sample. And in every environment that you go to, if you count how many you're able to see in the microscope versus how many you're able to grow, you see many, many more, usually orders of magnitude more things in the microscope than you are able to grow in the laboratory. And this is, you know, you're counting them on a plate, so that's why it's called the Great Plate Count Anomaly. And so culturing microbes is wonderful. I do a lot of work on microbes that we grow in the laboratory, but it's also insufficient for really understanding microbial diversity. And this vexed people for a long period of time, and then in the 1980s, an alternative approach was developed where you go to an environment and instead of looking in a microscope or in addition to looking in a microscope and trying to grow things in the lab, you extract DNA directly from your environmental sample and you characterize the organisms that are present in that sample by looking at the sequence of the DNA that you're able to get out of that sample. And so what I'm going to walk you through is a couple of sort of scenarios where people are studying microbes by looking at their DNA to show you what you know, sort of the possibilities are. So the first and sort of most obvious thing and the most common thing that people try to do with this DNA data is very straightforward, is to ask, who is out there in a community? So you go to a sample. You look in a microscope, you can't quite tell what the things are that are there. You try and grow things, not everything grows. You want to know what kinds of organisms are in that sample. If you went to a new island, you could do this with the plants and animals. I mean, every once in a while you find something weird that you're not sure what it is, but for, you know, most animals that you would find in a new island, you can assign them at least to major taxonomic groups, and you can even assign them sometimes down to the species level. So to do this with microbes, people have been turning to DNA analysis. And basically the way it works is you extract DNA from your environmental sample. Historically, the number one way that people would do this is they would use the polymerase chain reaction, a special biochemical method, to make copies of one gene in particular, gene for the component of the ribosome, the protein translation apparatus, called the ribosomal RNA gene. And it turns out that this gene is in all cellular organisms, and it's relatively easy to make copies of it using PCR from anything that is in your sample. And so you run this reaction, you make copies, billions of copies of the ribosomal RNA genes that are from your sample, and you read the string of letters that corresponds to the sequence of that gene in the organisms that are in your sample. You take that sequence and you compare it to other sequences from known organisms, you line them up, and then you build an evolutionary tree of those sequences just like you would build an evolutionary tree of bones or an evolutionary tree of leaf structures. And now you can tell by where your new ribosomal RNA sits in the tree of ribosomal RNAs what type of organism was in your environmental sample without ever growing it in the laboratory, without ever seeing it in the microscope. And you can do this in an environment that has one organism, like I'm representing here, one kind of organism there. And basically, again, this is akin to building an evolutionary tree of a new mammal and trying to figure out whether it's a rodent or a Felidae or some other thing. And we're doing the same thing with microbes. We're lining up the sequences of these genes to compare to each other, just like you would line up bones between different vertebrates. And then you build an evolutionary tree from that data. This was originally pioneered by someone named Carl Woese, who was doing it with cultured organisms, and then Norm Pace developed the methods to characterize ribosomal RNA directly from environmental samples. You place them onto now a tree of life rather than just a tree of individual organisms. Woese was sort of the revolutionary in the 1970s who pointed out that there were multiple lineages hidden within what were called prokaryotes at the time. Something that he named a new lineage called Archaebacteria, which was renamed the Archaea. But the details don't matter that much as the idea that you can take a piece of DNA from an environmental sample, build an evolutionary tree of it compared to known organisms, and figure out what that organism is from the environmental sample. Just as an aside, I assume you may know this or may not, but the vast majority of the phylogenetic diversity of life is microbial. That's what's shown in the dark here. There are only a few lineages that are multicellular. Now, if your environment has one organism in it, you can do this. If your environment has two kinds of organisms, you end up with two different kinds of ribosomal RNA sequences out at the end. You make this alignment of the sequences, you build an evolutionary tree, and now you can see that there are two different kinds of organisms in your environmental sample. If there were four organisms in your environmental sample, you should get four different positions in your evolutionary tree. And now you can figure out, in a complex community, what kinds of organisms are in that community. Now, when I was an undergraduate, I first started doing this with ribosomal RNA PCR in 1988. And I sequenced a single ribosomal RNA gene from a weird deep sea invertebrate with bacteria living inside of it. And I got a paper out of this, 1,500 base pairs of DNA, a single gene over 2 years. Now in our laboratory at UC Davis and all sorts of other laboratories around here, and my project probably costs like $50,000. Now in a day, we can generate 100 million sequences for $1,000. I mean, we can now characterize diversity of life via DNA sequencing because it is cheap and easy. DNA sequencing has just gone completely crazy. And this, of course, many people are using this for studying the human genome or studying various other big, furry, leafy organisms that I don't understand. But we can also apply it to looking at microbial diversity in a variety of ways. And just as an aside, I was talking in the back about, can you do this for field work? Mostly what people do is they bring DNA back to the lab and they sequence it, but there are now multiple companies that are claiming that they're going to have thumb drive type DNA sequencing apparatuses that you can take out into the field and do sequencing and get the data dumped into your laptop. It's really, sequencing has gone crazy. Now it's not just, we don't just want to know who is out there, we also want to understand what they're doing biochemically in the community. So we can go out to an environment now and rather than reading just the ribosomal RNA gene, we can read all the genes from organisms in the environment. So it's now known as metagenomics. And we can make predictions about the functions of those organisms. Rather than comparing the ribosomal RNA genes to other organisms, we can compare all the other genes to all the other genes that have been characterized from other organisms and make predictions about the functional properties of organisms, even though we have never grown them in the laboratory and never even seen some of them. Now, there are a million other uses for this type of DNA analysis. There are lots of cool studies that are coming out now where people are doing forensic reconstruction of ancient TB strains, or there was just one that came out on an ancient plague strain using DNA sequencing from mummies, or DNA sequencing from people who died hundreds or thousands of years ago and, of some particular disease. The biggest sort of hottest area of using DNA sequencing to study microbial diversity right now is studying what's called the human microbiome. So it turns out we're covered, as I assume everybody here knows, we're covered in a cloud of microbes. For many years, most people ignored most of this cloud of microbes. We paid attention to the pathogens, of course, because they kill us or make us sick or they kill other organisms. But the rest of the microbes that were living in and on us and in and on various plants and animals were, you know, largely ignored, not completely, but largely ignored. And until DNA sequencing got really cheap, we really didn't have a handle on the diversity of microbes that live in or on any plant or animal. And about 6 or 7 years ago now, there was a large consortium launched by the NIH called the Human Microbiome Project that started to use DNA sequencing to catalog the microbes in and on healthy people and now in and on people with various health ailments, characterizing all the different orifices and other sites where microbes tend to hang out on people. And this was largely inspired, or the funding was made available largely because of a couple of studies, including this one by Peter Turnbaugh in Jeffrey Gordon's lab at Washington University in St. Louis. They showed this amazing thing. So there's a mouse strain that has a genetic defect in one gene called the OB gene, the obese gene. And when it has this genetic defect, when they're homozygous mutants, they get fat. And here's a wild type mouse, and here's the giant OB double mutant fatty mouse here. And what they showed in this paper was that if you took, now they had shown already that the microbes in the obese mouse gut were different from the microbes in the wild type mouse. That's not that surprising. It clearly was having something weird going on in its gastrointestinal system to get to be so fat with the same diet, right? And what they showed was you could take the microbes out of an obese mouse, transplant them into a wild-type mouse that did not have any microbes in it, that was raised germ-free, and they got fat. So they did not have the OB mutation. They were wild-type mice, but they got the microbes that had grown up inside an OB double mutant mouse. So the obese phenotype was transmissible via the microbes. And this got, you know, convinced the NIH to put $150 million into the Human Microbiome Project and convinced the EU to do the same thing. And the human microbiome studies also went crazy along with DNA sequencing. And there's been all sorts of interesting stuff coming out since then where people are, you know, trying to rethink what it means to be human if we're covered in, you know, 10 times or 5 times as many microbial cells as there are human cells, and many more genes in the microbes than there are in the human genome. I love this. So there's this paper, I think it was also by Peter Turnbaugh, that reviewed some of the initial studies of the human microbiome, where the colors here represent different major lineages of bacteria and what their proportions are in different parts of the body. And for some reason, they felt that this had to be an anatomically correct figure, which I have censored. The initial study showed very clearly was that basically the human body is the equivalent of the Earth in terms of a biogeographical range. You have an incredible diversity of different locations, and the microbes are very different between these different sites, between the mouth and the stomach and the gastrointestinal tract and the skin and the vagina and every other place. There's incredible variation in the microbes that you find there within an individual person. And you can zoom in and show that this, you know, the finer scale that you look, your elbow is really dry. It's got different microbes than your forehead. And, you know, the left hand has slightly different microbes than the right hand in people who are left-handed and so on. We are a planet relative to the microbes. And what's probably most interesting about this is that there are many lines of evidence now that it's not just in this OB mouse, but that across different people, there's lots of variation in the microbial communities in different sites. When you compare people with different health statuses, like Crohn's disease versus healthy versus ulcerative colitis. Those people have different microbial communities, and they're consistently similar within the Crohn's disease population and different to the other populations. So there's a correlation between what microbes you see and a diversity of health states. And in animal models and in a few human studies, they're now showing that these can be causative differences for certain health states. Now, most of the studies are still correlations only. And it could be that you get Crohn's disease, for example, and then the microbes change. The microbes might not be causing the difference in Crohn's disease, but it's pretty clear that there are some phenotypes, certainly many in mouse, and some in humans that appear to be caused by variation in the microbial communities that you find in different sites. Now, we know epidemiologically a lot about various human behaviors that disturb the microbial community that lead to other problems. So, for example, C-section, babies born by C-section on average have a higher risk of a variety of long-term, you know, not incredibly terrible health problems, and the risk isn't particularly high, but things like allergy and asthma and some autoimmune diseases increase in people who've been born by C-section. Now, one thing that happens when you're born by C-section is you don't get colonized by the microbes found in the mother's birth canal. You're carved out of the mother and put aside, and you don't get colonized by the microbes, which are basically, I think that vaginal birth is a delivery system in part for microbial diversity. And so all other animals on the planet do this. Plants even deliver microbes in seeds, and C-section leads to disturbances in the microbial community. The reason I have pigpen here is that kids who are overly clean also have higher risk of allergy, asthma, autoimmune diseases, and so on. And again, it has not been proven that this is caused by shifts in the microbial community, but that's a pretty good model right now for what's going on in these states. And then this is the last, you know, thing. Hopefully everybody's stopped eating now. So we can disturb the microbial community either by human behavior or by various health ailments. And how can we restore the microbial community? What many people try to do is take probiotics, right? Probiotics are sort of the equivalent to Mount St. Helens erupting and then planting poplar trees to reestablish the microbial community, I mean the plant community at Mount St. Helens. We've got tens of thousands of microbes in it. Taking one strain or five strains of probiotics in a pill is not really going to help restore the full ecology of the microbial community. So what do you do? Well, here's a case study that is now getting a lot of press. People with persistent Clostridium difficile infections, horrible, horrible things you can get. In particular, after you take antibiotics, your body can be taken over by this one bacterium, Clostridium difficile. It's a spore-forming bacteria like Bacillus anthracis, the causative agent of anthrax, and it's very hard to get rid of. And people can have this infection leading to persistent diarrhea and other health problems for 20 years. And they cannot get rid of it with antibiotics. Well, people who have this health problem in recent years have been undergoing what's called a fecal transplant. It is what it sounds like. And you get a microbial community from a healthy donor, and it has, as far as I've seen in the last studies, something on the order of a 95% success rate in curing C. diff infections. I mean, just completely astonishing for this type of treatment where antibiotics weren't working at all. And a microbial community delivered in various ways can restore health in these individuals. So the human microbiome is sort of just the poster child of microbial diversity studies, but we can take the same methods, the same approaches, the same cheap sequencing, and apply it anywhere on the planet now. So we can do global biogeography of microbes by sampling soil or leaves or other parts of the environment from all around the planet and get a map of global microbial biogeography. Now, it's not going to be as fine scale resolution as you might want, but people are already doing this. We can sample the world around us. So there's a new effort funded by the Sloan Foundation, which I have a grant from, to study the microbial ecology of our buildings, which is really important for probably our health and other aspects of our lives. It's gotten to the point where microbial characterization is so efficient and relatively cheap that there are now 10 or so citizen science efforts related to sampling microbial diversity. We're doing a couple of them at Davis. There are many around the country and a few in other countries where they're getting people to go out swabbing, you know, houses or swabbing floors or collecting soil samples, sending the samples back to a lab, and in a week later you can have, you know, 10,000 DNA sequences from each of those samples and a plot of the diversity of those samples. And so I think we are getting to the point now, I didn't talk about this with birds, but I've been inspired by the birders like the Cornell Bird Observatory, which has people, hundreds of thousands of people around the world collecting information about bird biogeography and posting it to their apps and their websites. And we are at the point where we can almost start to do this globally with microbes. So I said that there was this challenge, you know, microbes, the appearance isn't that useful, they're small, they're really diverse. But fortunately, the cheap DNA sequencing has come along, and even though it was targeted towards the human genome, we can co-opt those methods and those approaches to studying microbial diversity. So I view this as the microbe era in biology. Microbes do run the planet, so we better understand what microbes are doing. And you know, again, I'm not going to give up on my birds because I love birds. We're actually trying to combine the two and do bird microbiome studies. I got to find ways to get out in the field. Can we get to a field guide to the microbes? I think so. I think that as DNA sequencing is probably going to continue to get, you know, exponentially cheaper and easier, studying microbes, it's going to be different than going out and looking at birds around the planet, but we're going to be able to do the same thing and have this global field guide to microbes on the planet. So I will stop there.